Thank you very much. It is a very nice conference, so I am glad to be here to present part of my dissertation. This part that I will present today is related to 1973, a very particular year in the history of Argentina and also in the history of Israel, because in Israel it was the Yom Kippur War. That is not going to be part of the presentation today, but because it happened at the end of the year almost, but also in 1973, the exile political leader Perón, he returned to Argentina, so Argentina had a Peronist government. In this presentation, I will start with an introduction. I will talk a little bit about Argentinian context. I will talk about the profile of the immigrants that came from Argentina in 1973, and I will give some conclusions. Okay, first of all, if we pay attention to the number of immigrants that came from Argentina along the history since the beginning of Israel, since the creation of Israel, we see fluctuations. Those fluctuations make us questions many things. I will focus today in 1973, when 2,800 people came to here from Argentina. In the past, people used to come on board ships, then started to come on board planes. Okay, something about the Argentine economy that I feel I must say before starting to discuss about Argentina. The Argentinian economy has a problem, a structural limitation still today. The foreign currency arrives to Argentina through the primary sector, through the export of goods that comes from agricultural or yes, mainly agricultural. In the past used to be corn, today is soybean. But the sector that provides jobs to the Argentine people is mainly the factories, the industry. So substitution of imports made by Argentina was very good to provide jobs, and it was domestic oriented. People, the workers and the middle class, they were focused on the domestic market. But this, this structural base has a limitation. After a cycle of expansion, you have a crisis because you don't have enough foreign currency to provide your economy the goods that you have to buy abroad. Even your industry that is domestic oriented needs machines or all kind of products that you have to buy abroad. This is working still today. So if you understand this, you can understand Argentinian problems even today. So Argentina grew up or developed its economy in a system that is called stop and go, because you go, but then you stop, you have a crisis. In each crisis, you have devaluations of your Argentinian currency. With the devaluations, everything changes. So every couple of years, the so-called Argentinian middle class cannot afford the private school, cannot afford going to the gym or buying the kind of goods that they are used to buy every couple of years. This is very important to understand, because in the descriptions of the Jewish community of Argentina, you can find documents that say this is a wealthy community. And you have a document from the same year that it says this is a community of weak middle class or working class. So it is very confusing if you don't understand this. Okay. Now, what happened to the middle class when Perón returned in 1973? This is a question because this leader won elections with 62% of the electoral list. So there is a debate today what happened with the middle class, because he used to have the votes of the working class, but not that much in the middle class. So there are some hypotheses. The first hypothesis is that the middle class turned left. This is the hypothesis of historian Ezequiel Adamowski. There was a middle class turned left. I am talking about the middle class because the Jews traditionally were, in this period of time, they were associated to the middle class. In all the reports and some of the things I will explain today are connected to the hopes I am connecting to what Gur said before. Immigrants have hopes, and because they were from the middle class, I want to talk about the hopes of the middle class. So one researcher says there was a turn left, but another hypothesis by other researchers says no, they were in the center. They were in the center. There was not a peronization or a turn left. So my hypothesis about the middle class in Argentina, and here I am taking the Jewish immigrants as a case study to move or to study the middle class behavior in Argentina in 73. My hypothesis is that they were everywhere in the political spectrum. If I take the Jews in Argentina in 73, there was a part going into the guerrilla movement, and there was other part going to exile because they did not want to be in the country. Exile or emigrating. So in this presentation, I will talk about those that immigrated to Israel. If we pay attention to 73 was the part of the economic cycle that was expansion. It was the expansive part of the cycle. This graphic is the number of immigrants to Israel from Argentina, but I added the symbols that I used before to explain economy. In a sense, this presentation is a contrast, offers a contrast to what happened in 63. In 63, where, okay, it's not included here, it was in the graph at the beginning, 63 was one of the peaks of Argentine immigration to Israel, and it was driven by economic crisis in Argentina, among other factors, but it was a very, very strong factor. 73, my hypothesis is that economic needs, economic crisis in Argentina was not the main factor. Either I would emphasize the political violence. We are talking about a population that went through social mobility along many years, but then we have, since 69, the country was under dictatorship, a very, very hard dictatorship that prohibited all kind of political practice, and they also implemented economic reforms that severed the conditions of the middle class and the workers. And if you pay attention to documents from the from 1970, the Jewish community, when I say community, I am talking about the institutions, they were suffering the crisis in 70. And there were a lot of Jews that were going to cafeterias to receive food. They were unemployed and receiving food from the Jewish institutions. This was in the 70s. But in 73, you don't find nothing like this, because Argentina changes very quickly. This is why I explained the economic dynamic before. Instead, you have violence. In 69, you have a rebellion against the dictatorship in the province of Córdoba. the part of the word aso at the end in Spanish means something really big. So we use in Argentina a lot to explain politics. So this rebellion, civil rebellion, workers and students against the militaries, took two days for the army to control the city again. So you can imagine, and it spread all over the country in different asos, Rosario, Aso, other cities, they did the same. And since then, different guerrilla groups developed in the country. Perón was in exile. He was 18 years in exile. Then you have when Perón was about to come back to Argentina, one of his followers was in the presidency. Already the dictatorship was had organized a process of transition to democracy, and Peronism is again at office. And you have the devotazo. What was the devotazo? All the activists from the guerrillas that were in jail, they were set free. The same day, the very same day that Campora went to office, Campora was the president, the follower of Perón, that actually Perón was the strong man in Argentinian politics, but Campora was the president. There was the idea to give amnesty to political prisoners, but at the end it was made by force. Like after a popular demonstration, 30,000 people went walking to Devoto. Devoto is the neighborhood where the jail was, and they put everyone in the street. So you can imagine, if you are a person that you are just trying to work during the day to have some money to pay your holidays, you want to take your kid to the school, you can imagine what kind of feelings you can have if in your country you are witnessing these kind of processes. Then we have also, when Perón returned to the country, there was a massacre that even today we don't know how many people died. What happened? The Peronist movement, the followers of Perón, were divided into left and wing and right wing. And they were fighting to see which one was going to be in the first place in Ezeiza. Ezeiza is the area of the international airport. So there was a shooting between Peronists, and even today we don't know how many people died. So in that manner, the Peronist government started to be at office, let's say. And the international context in the region, you have a young Fidel Castro, and you have Salvador Allende in Chile. So the idea of revolution was something of the period. It was not just imagination. We can discuss if there were really possibilities for a revolution in Argentina, if the guerrilla was really a military threat. We can discuss that. But in everyday life, it was there. It was there. So now I would like to talk a little bit about some of the characteristics that the immigrants from Argentina that arrived in Israel had in 1973. And I had them because I found a report from the Jewish Agency, and I made comparisons with the previous work that Sebastian Clore have done for 63. So if we pay attention to university graduates, I put this is the University of Buenos Aires flag, let's say, or stamp, but Argentina in general, in every province, has even today public universities that are for free. And one traditional way for social mobility was going to the university. if we compare this, in 63 there were among the immigrants to Israel 13% of graduates, university graduates. In 73 we have above 25. This can be a little bit, it is not exact because this information relates to Latin Americans, but many times I have to use this information because it's what it is available. But I assume even it could be higher because Argentina, for different reasons, it could be even higher. So, but this is not the only thing that I found. I found that there was less manual workers than in 63 and more students also. I have this table that I made using the report I found about 73, this particular year, with the information and the socio-demographic profile that Sebastian Clore made, and I found that manual workers in the textile industry, where you have to use your hands and to cut the fabric and all kind of manual works, manual jobs, there was a diminution. And you have more students in 73. One of the typical behaviors of the social mobility. You can provide more years of education to your kids. And also the agricultural sector, it was inferior in 73. The Jewish colonization agency that Gur Alvaroy mentioned before, they had one of their main projects in Argentina. And even today, the main soybeans producer in Argentina, he started in the Jewish colonization agency. But now he is a tycoon. You have no small producers today. So this was 73. Okay. So another very small indicator, the number of people coming by air was bigger. It was 40% in December. This can be anecdotic because the Jewish agency was changing, but in particular in December, after the Yom Kippur War, and after Peronism was at office, was increasing. So now I want to talk about the expectations and the housing shortage that was experiencing Israel. People in Argentina, before coming, they were told officially by emissaries and by this magazine, for example. This magazine is the official informative report of the Jewish agency, the Tnuat Aliyah, the Movement for Immigration. They told everyone that they will have the right to receive a home for rent or to buy, and if it was for rent, they will have the option to buy later and to use what they paid before as rent, as part of the mortgage, to buy the home. So they were told this. This middle class was told that they will have the right to buy a home. This was in Argentina. In Argentina, I know that many of the immigrants coming in 73, they had homes, because I found in many, many letters and reports of the Jewish agency emissaries that they say there are problems to sell properties. The immigrants have problems to sell properties due to economic fluctuations here. By the way, real estate in Argentina is in dollars because you don't trust the local currency, so you do everything in dollars. With the fluctuations, you cannot sell. You have no idea how much is going to be the dollar tomorrow. And the Peronist government also put a new law about tenants. You could not be a tenant of the home you sold before. Let's say I have a home. I sell the home to a friend because I go to Israel, but I want to keep to continue living there until the last day I do my emigration. It was not possible because of the law. And also it became very risky to do short-time sublet or short-time renting, because you don't want a tenant for a few months. It's very dangerous because if he does not pay, you cannot put him on the street under this new regulation. So it was a recurrent topic in the reports from Argentina. So I know that many of them had homes. Okay. What happened in Israel? Since the Six-Day War, many immigrants came to here. Immigration rose very, very pronouncedly. So there were not enough homes to everyone. It was not a personal issue. Some people took it personal. Simply, there were not homes. It is more easy to invite people than to provide homes to all of them. So I found many letters of people complaining. This letter is about a person, is from a person that he used to be a Zionist activist for 30 something years. He was ready to open a small factory of nylon bags, plastic bags here in Israel, but he did not receive his home. He was told he was going to receive a home. After 200 days, he did not receive his home. And he said, my wife started to talk about return. And I am very sad, and my daughters also, they received Jewish and Zionist education. So we see that they used their Jewish and Zionist identities in their complaints. There were also collective protests or complaints. This is a picture from Ulpan, an absorption center where people were studying Hebrew. Most of them were professionals, and they say we suffer discrimination, we see other immigrants receiving homes, and we are not receiving an apartment. And it happened in a sense because they were absorption centers. Before, the collective protest was impossible. Now you have people all together in the same place, paying attention what the other immigrant receive and why I do not receive the same. Okay, but at the end, and I am very close to finish, at the end, the 70s were a golden period to buy a home in Israel. According to some studies, after independence and during the 70s, it was the best period to buy a home here. And actually, Latin American immigrants, after the third year, 47% of them, from those arrived between 69 and 73, had a home here in Israel. Also, I guess, if they had a home, they paid with a mortgage, at least they had something before. So those that came, they were a kind of consolidated middle class. So some conclusions. The Jewish people can be used as a case study to study the Argentine middle class for some issues. The economic aspirations and not the economic need was what was driving those that came in 73. And again, I go back to hopes, and not only needs. Also, you need hopes to understand migrations. And another conclusion, a state trying to promote immigration has to be careful about what they say, because you can create disappointment in the immigrants if you promoted more than you are really, really ready to give. And the identity and the use of identity to bargain and to make your case when you have a problem in the country you are an immigrant, I think this is a good point to raise questions for comparative studies. I would like to know if someone that is an immigrant in Canada is going to complain against the state because he received an apartment in Ontario and not in Vancouver or whatever. I would like to do some comparative studies about that. Thank you very much.